Please join me in our call to worship and prayer of the day, and this will be read responsively. Incline your ear, O Lord, and answer me, for I am poor and needy.
Preserve my life. Save your servant. Trust in you. You are my God.
Be gracious to me, O Lord, for to you do I cry all the day. There is none like you among the gods, O Lord, nor are there any works like yours.
All the nations you have made shall glorify your name, for you alone are God.
Teach me your way, O Lord, that I may walk in your truth.
For great is your steadfast love toward me.
Turn to me and be gracious to me. Give strength to your servant. Good and wonderful Father, Lord, who gives us all that we need and who gives us even more, Lord. Father, whose gifts are abundant, Lord, and gifts are as generous as the rain that falls from the sky. Father, we ask that your Spirit would pour down upon us here in this hour. As we gather here in the name of our Lord and Savior Christ, we ask that he would, as he promised us, be here in the midst of us. And so we open our hearts and minds to him and pray, Lord Jesus, be in the midst of us today. Christ, be in the midst of us today as a Savior, but reminding us of all your great works, Lord. Be in the midst of us, Lord, as the incarnation of the living God. A reminder of all that you have done for us, O Lord. Be in the midst of us, O Savior, Lord, and lift us up out of darkness today. Be in the midst of us as a Savior and save us from our sins. Be in the midst of us, O Christ, and grant us forgiveness and the heart to forgive others. As we gather today, Lord, may we remember how amazing your grace is towards us, how amazing your many gifts are towards us. Father, as we gather today, may we remember that we are your children, as you have made us to be. Father, grant us the grace, Lord, to worship you today. Grant us the Spirit. Grant us the words, Lord, and where the words fail, Lord, give us that groaning too deep for words in the depths of every prayer that we make to you. Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for this time to gather. Thank you for all that you are and all that you have made us. And all God's people said, amen.
The King of Glory.
Please be seated. Well, good morning. It's great to see all of you here in the house of our God and King. On this, the day that the Lord has made, let us truly rejoice and be glad in it. And it's always a good day to be alive, but especially a day like this when we get to gather with our brothers and sisters in the house of God. So I want to extend a welcome to all of you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We're glad you've joined us here today. And if you're a visitor here with us, we'd like to extend a special welcome and let you know anything you need to follow along with the service. It's going to be printed right here on your bulletin. And if you're watching us recorded or live, then all that you need to know is going to appear on the screen at the appropriate time. There are a few quick announcements I would like to bring to your attention. And all these announcements you can also find in your connector as well. Small groups continue to meet this week. I think the women are changing up. There's one of them is not meeting, one's meeting, so make sure you check your connector about all of that. But a youth meeting tonight and Theology on Tap Monday, and the men continue to meet as well on Wednesday. But again, just check your connector if you're interested in any of those groups. We encourage you to join. Yard sale is coming up real quick. It's going to be this weekend. So we have a deadline. If you want to bring some stuff to the church to donate to the yard sale, please bring it by Wednesday the 8th, no later than Wednesday the 8th. So we need that stuff in quickly if you want to include it in the yard sale. Again, all proceeds go to fund our Costa Rica mission trip next summer. And we also need some help for that. There's some sign-up sheets over there on the other side of the water cooler. We need some people to help break down, some people to set up, and on Friday and Saturday, people to man the yard sale as well. So if you got some time, we really would appreciate your help. And if you're here right now, we could actually use it right after the service. We're going to be breaking down the church, stacking the chairs, and bringing some tables in. So if any of y'all wouldn't mind giving us just maybe 10 minutes, we can get it done in a hurry. So that would be very helpful. After that, we also remind you that our Pray May is also continuing this week. This is a challenge for you to pray every day in the month of May and to see how God will change things in your life and how God will respond when we come to Him faithfully in prayer. You can sign up for the prompts through the Remind app or talk to Liz. There's also the prompts. There's a poster back there in the hallway. You can just take a picture of that and remind yourself of those prompts as well. We encourage you to join us in that also. And finally, we're going to be doing a new fundraiser with, not a collection for Thornwell. And Harris is going to tell us a little bit more about that.
Good morning. Thornwell has a program called Strengthening Families. They have expanded their ministries to cover the spectrum of child care and family care. Laurie Pitts has worked with the Strengthening Families before. So this year, they have requested a supply drive for specific items. The church, the session approved a team, a Thornwell Missions team, to include Laurie. How can I do this? Jenny Coward. Whoop. Y'all, I had a fall 2 weeks ago, so the brain's still not right. And the team selected 5 items to collect, and we need them in numbers of 12 each because they serve 12 families at each Strengthening Families session. There are going to be sign-up sheets. There are right now on the back table, the round table in the back. If you would like to sign up today, you can go ahead and do that. You may commit to more than one item. Like if you want to do 3 bowl mixing sets, that's fine. You decide what you would like to contribute. We will have baskets back there for everything beginning, well, next Sunday, because we need to clear it out for the yard sale Friday and Saturday. But the announcement is not in the connector this week, but it was in the May newsletter that we all received, so pay attention to that. One major change, they requested snack boxes, individual Frito-Lay snacks, and I wrote sets of 50, but we're going to knock that down to 28. 50 snack packs is a lot. So on the sign-up sheet, it says 28. And so we encourage you to participate in this and help us reach our goal. I met the director of the Strengthening Families program yesterday at Thornwell Spring Festival. Laurie and Colin were there. It was a little bit rainy, but it was doable. And we had a good turnout. And there were lots of good strawberries picked yesterday. They are delicious. So we encourage you to participate in the month of May. The items will be delivered to Thornwell on June the 8th. So you have the whole month of May to participate. Thank you.
And what 5 items are we collecting?
We're collecting laundry detergent, so it can be powder or pods. Snacks in bulk, 28. 3 bowl mixing sets. Clorox wipes, a set of 3. And Walmart gift cards for $10. So we need 12 Walmart gift cards, 12 sets of Clorox wipe, 12 sets of 3 bowl mixing sets, 12 28-pack snack packs, and 12 laundry detergent containers. And we encourage you to participate as much and as often as you would like.
Yeah.
Okay, thanks.
Well, thank you.
So sorry.
My wife asked if she can talk. That's a new one. She's never asked that before.
So the evening women's Bible study information in the connector is actually wrong. We are meeting for dinner this Wednesday to celebrate the end of a season together, but we're going to meet at O'Hara's Pub, Public House, at 6:30 on Wednesday. So any woman who wants to join is welcome to, but let me know so I can make sure we've got enough seats at the restaurant. And then June 1st is coming really fast. We have a vacation Bible school, Bible day camp is what we're calling it now. Bible day camp, one day on June 1st, and that's right around the corner. So there is a sign-up sheet out under the rack. We have a new little table with sign-up sheets. If you would like to participate in that day, please let me know or go find out, find the list and see how you can participate. We had over 40 kids last year, and the majority of them were from the community, and so we're hoping that those kids are going to return and bring their friends, and so we need all the hands and feet that we can have. Thanks.
And I believe that is no more announcements, then we would like to invite the children of the church to come forward to join Nell by the baptismal font here for a moment for children.
Good morning.
Good
How are you?
Good.
Y'all had a good week?
Yes, ma'am.
You behaved in school?
Yes, ma'am.
Good. Lily, you didn't behave in school, and you owning up to it. Does your mama know that? She does. Okay. Okay. How many of you like fruit? Avery, you don't like fruit? All right, name me a fruit that you like, Scott.
Strawberries,
okay. Lily?
Strawberries.
Give me another one. We want some variety here. That's the only fruit that you like.
I have another one that's different.
Okay.
Watermelon.
Yes, there's a lot of things. You've got grapes, bananas, peaches, plums, pears, and they're all good, but did you know that fruits are good for you?
Mm-hmm.
Which fruit do you think is the best one that they say is good for you? Which one do you think? Have you ever heard, I'm not going to say the fruit, and blank a day keeps the doctor away. Apples, right. And, you know, they taste good. The oranges have vitamin C in it. That's good for you. So, and you know, if you're looking for something to take to your teacher, they always love apples. So that would be just a nice treat to say, have a good day. All right, today we're talking about fruit. And we're not talking about apples and oranges. It's about a different kind of fruit. The fruit of the Spirit, okay? We are talking about the way we act when we put our faith in Jesus. We ask Him to forgive us of our sins, and we promise to be His followers. The Bible tells us that when we do that, the Holy Spirit fills us with God's love and produces some good fruit in our life. Now, you know what kind of fruit I'm talking about in your life, right? Not like the apples and oranges, but the fruit of the Holy Spirit.
Apples and oranges are still good.
Apples and oranges are still good. Scott, you're correct on that. And when you see an apple tree, you expect to see apples on the tree, right? All right. Well, when you see someone who is filled with the Holy Spirit, you expect to see what the Bible calls the Spirit. And it's the fruit of that Spirit. And it is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. That's a lot of Spirit, isn't it? Yes. Oh my, that is some good fruit, isn't it? And it helps us with our, when we think about being good, doing what the Holy Spirit wants us to do, then we can think about those kind of fruits as well, okay? Are you always patient? Scott, are you always patient?
No.
Avery, are you?
No.
Lily?
Like in the middle.
In the middle, okay.
I try to always be patient.
Yeah, we all try, but it doesn't work sometimes, does it? Okay, are you always gentle and kind? Usually?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Lily?
Same.
Okay. All right. You know, there will be times when we do fail because we can't be patient all the time. Sometimes we just, you know, have to lose our patience a little bit. But then we're not perfect. Absolutely. And so, but then we can ask for forgiveness if we've done something that we shouldn't and, you know, lost our patience. And we ask to be forgiven and filled with the Holy Spirit so that you can produce the kind of fruit that the Spirit provides for you. Okay, so always remember that. It's okay if you get a little impatient. You wouldn't be normal if you didn't. Okay? All right, who wants to pray us out today? Okay, Scott.
Dear God, we might always not be perfect like Jesus and you, but we always will try to be kind, gentle, patient, and all the fruits of the Spirit. And one day, everything that we can do may be perfect. Amen.
Thank you, Scott. Now y'all go, be patient this week, and be kind. Have a good week.
Friends, we always do good to remember that our Lord Jesus can sympathize with us in every single one of our weaknesses. Since in every way that we are tempted, he also was tempted, yet he was without sin. Let us then with boldness approach the throne of grace that we may receive mercy and find the grace to help us in our time of need. So let us come and confess our sins together, first in quiet reflection in our hearts and to God alone, and then together as it's printed in our bulletin. Let us pray. And now together. Merciful God, forgive me, for I am a sinner in your sight. I have broken your law. I have strayed from the path of righteousness. I have sinned against you, against my neighbor, and against myself. I am helpless before my own evil, O God, and I cannot save myself. These are the sins I confess to you, great Father. Grant me, I pray, the forgiveness that only you can grant. Give me the strength that only you can give. Show me the way to righteousness that is your way alone. In Christ Jesus we pray. Amen. Friends, hear the good news. The wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. I declare to you in the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
We're now going to stand and sing hymn number 359, More Love to Thee, O Christ.
Thank you.
be seated. Our scripture passage today comes from the Gospel according to Luke, verses 24, 44 to 49. Now before we read this, let's pause for a moment in prayer. Good and wonderful Father, we thank you today for this words of Holy Scripture that you have given us, Lord, that your will might be made known to us in our lives. Father, as we come here today to approach this word, Lord, fill us with your Holy Spirit and open our hearts and minds that as we hear and as we read, we may also understand. Lord, bless this holy reading of your holy word. And may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. This is the gospel according to Luke chapter 24, verses 44 to 49. Listen now to the word of the Lord. Then Jesus said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures and said to them, "Thus it is written that the Christ should suffer and on the third day rise from the dead, and that repentance for the forgiveness of sins should be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things, and behold, I am sending the promise of my Father upon you. But stay in the city until you are clothed with power from on high." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So these past few weeks, we have been going through the Apostles' Creed. And this is the one creed, this one statement that that sums up best what we believe as Christians, the basics of Christian belief. Now today we come to a part of this doctrine that I guess I would call the odd man out. Not that it's odd, not that it doesn't belong, but if you're doing one of those tests when you would say which one of these is the most different from the others, I think today this one would be that doctrine, the forgiveness of sins. The one that stands out a lot different than all the others in the creed. And the reason it appears that way to me is everything in the creed is big, right? It's epic. It's huge. It's like universal stuff going on, right? We have God. We've got the creation of the world. We've got the incarnation of Jesus, you know, the virgin birth, a death, a descent into hell, rising again to new life, ascending into heaven, coming back to judge the living and the dead, the big universal church, the resurrection of the body, eternal life. They're these real big things, right? They're huge. And then squeezed in there, right in between the universal church and the resurrection of the body, you have the forgiveness of sins. Almost like slipped in there like an afterthought. When all these giant pieces of doctrine, these universal world-changing events, and there we have the forgiveness of sins. It's kind of easy to pass this one over. It's kind of easy not to think about it a whole lot, because, well, maybe we talk about it so much, right? We talk about it every Sunday. We just did our prayer confession. We confess our sins. I tell you, you're forgiven. And, well, maybe it's because we talk about it so much. It doesn't seem as big and as epic as these other pieces of doctrine. Or maybe we underestimate it. Maybe we underestimate how big this forgiveness of sins really is. And we have forgotten truly how epic it is. And maybe, again, it's because we say it a lot, or maybe it's because we don't fully understand it. And because we don't fully understand what really happens when we are forgiven for our sins, we don't always realize how much we need this doctrine, how much we rely upon this doctrine. And in fact, nothing else in the Apostles' Creed is really that great of a doctrine if this little one, the forgiveness of sins, the very promise of Christ, is not in here as well. So when we look at the scripture, we find that, the forgiveness of sins plays such a huge role in the ministry of Jesus. I mean, of all the things he taught, of all that he did, what was truly unique and different about Christ and what he did was offering the forgiveness of sins to all people. And it started right out the gate with John the Baptist. What did he say? Repent and believe, for the kingdom of God is near. And repentance is all just a preparation for the forgiveness of sins. When Jesus first began his ministry, he would say the same thing. Repent. He preached repentance for the forgiveness of sins in order that you might be brought into the kingdom of God. Almost every time Jesus healed somebody, he said, your sins are forgiven. And one of the main things he fought about with the Pharisees the most was his authority, or whether or not he actually had the authority to forgive sins. It was a huge part of his ministry. It was all over the place. And in this passage we read today from Luke, as he's given his disciples his final instructions, what he tells them to preach is the forgiveness of sins. And he says, go preach everywhere. Tell everybody about this forgiveness of sins. And so it's no surprise when the apostles show up in Acts and they're preaching, what they're mainly preaching about is the forgiveness of sins. And this is truly what puts the good in the good news. This doctrine that our sins are forgiven. I think there's another reason why we don't really understand how big this is, or sometimes how the importance of this doctrine passes us by. And that's because we don't realize what a big deal sin is. We don't fully grasp how big a deal that is in our life. Or what we don't really fully realize is that sin is the great human problem. And when I say the great human problem, I'm saying, what is the big problem, the biggest problem human beings face? Bigger than climate change, bigger than political upheaval, bigger than war, bigger than starvation. The great human problem we face is sin and evil. And we've forgotten a lot of that because our culture, and I'm not saying us here, but our culture as a whole, has almost removed the word sin from its vocabulary. You don't hear about it talked too much, sin and evil. And if you do hear about sin, it's about past sins, the sins of America, the sins of oppression. And if you hear evil, it's only talked about when it's really, really big evil, like the Holocaust or serial killers or something like that. You don't hear about my evil, my sin, your evil, and your sin. About 20 years ago, articles started appearing that the word sin was being removed from our common everyday parlance. Now, you don't see any of those articles anymore, but true to their prediction, the word sin has almost disappeared. Now, we like to say other things besides sin and evil. We like to say things like, you just made a mistake. It's not sin, it's a mistake, or it's a personal failing, a little fault that you have. And we don't use the word evil that much anymore. It's a disease, right? Or it's some kind of illness that you have instead of sin and evil. See, what we've done is we've euphemized the words sin and evil. We've rebranded them. We've reframed them so they don't seem quite as bad. And if sin and evil don't seem quite as bad, then forgiveness isn't such a big deal. I remember when my kids are going in school, you know, in young, like kindergarten, elementary school, the teachers would make a point of telling the kids if they had done something bad that day. We don't tell them that they were bad. We don't like to tell the kids that they were bad. We say, you made the wrong choices. And I guess I get it. I can see where they're coming from, but sometimes kids are just bad. I mean, and I'm saying this as being a kid once, who I knew the choice I would make was wrong, but I did it anyway. Sometimes kids are just bad. Sometimes you have a call, just bad, bad. To me, it's a lot like you get a bad case of food poisoning, and the doctor says, I don't want to say you're sick. I like to say you made some poor culinary choices, like eating sushi from a gas station. Let's not do that again. But now listen, I'm not one that likes to pile on guilt. I don't like to do that. I'm not one that wants to pile guilt and shame on a person. Right? I don't think it's good. I don't think it's really healthy either to just belabor you about how much sin you have. And I'm not the kind of preacher that says, you're an awful sinner. You, all of you sinners, you're reprobates. Don't you know the bad things you've done? You've made Jesus very, very sad with all the bad things you've done. You should feel awful. Now, if you've been here for a while, you know I'm not that kind of preacher. And I like to think that I'm modeling myself off of Jesus because he wasn't that kind of preacher. He didn't beat people up about the bad things he've done and the sins they may have committed or not committed. But also, to beat someone up and just try to get guilt and shame in a person is also not an effective way to deal with a great human problem. The problem of sin and evil. Now, here's one thing every religion and philosophy and outlook in the world has in common. They've all tried to deal with a great human problem. Every religion. And our modern day religion does the same thing. It tries to deal with this great human problem. Now you might think, oh, we don't have a religious culture. We're secular. Well, we actually are a very religious culture. Except our religion is something called humanism. We believe in ourselves as gods. If you don't believe me, just look around a bit. We do. We have decided to claim ourselves as God. And this human religion, this religion of claiming the self as God, has tried to deal with this great human problem by reframing it all, by changing the way we look at sin and evil. Now, of course, if we're the gods, we can't say we're sin and evil. That would make us real puny gods indeed. So we say the problem is something different. It's not sin. It's not evil. The problem is a lack of education. It's a lack of opportunity. That's the problem. Or the problem is unresolved psychiatric issues coming from past traumas. Or maybe the problem is unbalanced brain hormones or bad chemicals in the brain. And now don't get me wrong. Those are real problems, okay? They are. They are real problems. Education, opportunity. You know, brain imbalances, those are real problems. But they're not the great human problem. They're not the problem of sin and evil. And the humanist solution is to call sin something else. It's to blame somebody else. It's been reframed so we can kind of ignore it and not really face up to it. And so they've invented this sinless culture. They've also invented a culture of victimhood. But it doesn't matter how you reframe it. Evil doesn't go away by calling it something else. Evil and sin don't disappear because you've reframed it and rebranded it and given it a more palatable name. This is why humanism will fail, as every other religion has failed in encountering the great human problem. Because the great human problem is evil. It's not education, it's not opportunity, it's not disease. It's the evil in the world, and it's the evil in us. Great Christian writer G.K. Chesterton was once offered to write an essay for a magazine. It was for this thematic issue that was coming out. So they invited him to write this essay, and it had one question. The question was, what's wrong with the world today? And man, we could write a lot about that, couldn't we? I mean, just let the paper keep coming. We could write about that for days. What's wrong with the world? Oh, let me tell you what's wrong with the world. Now, G.K. Chesterton, though, gave the best answer I've ever heard to what's wrong with the world. He answered it with two words. Two words. What's wrong with the world? His answer, I am. That's what he said, I am. I am. What's wrong with the world? What Chesterton was admitting was the problem of the world is sin and evil. And I am the sin and evil of the world. I am the sinner. I am what's broken. I am what has gone wrong with the world. If sin and evil are disease, then we are all infected. Now, other religions try to overcome this sin, try to overcome this with better laws or better atonement rituals or better political stances, better political parties, better social movement. Humanism tries to overcome it by blaming others and reframing the problem. But Christ came up with a unique solution to the great human problem. He allowed his body to be broken, and he poured out his blood that the law of God might be fulfilled and we could be forgiven. Now let me point out to you that when God forgives, it's not like when human beings forgive. When we forgive, it's a great struggle, isn't it? We wrestle with it. We try to move on. We try to forget about it. We try not to hold a grudge, but it's still there. It still eats away at us, and maybe a little bit of a time we can start to get over it. We just do our best to treat that person that we've tried to forgive and not let them think that we're still angry at them. I mean, it is such a great struggle. But the way God forgives is different. The way God forgives, he wipes the sin away. He takes the stain of sin and evil from the soul and he removes it completely. And it's as if it was never there to begin with. Colossians 2:14 says that he cancels the record of debt caused by our sin. The debt is canceled out completely. It is gone and it's never to come back. Hebrews 10:14 says that God will remember our sins no more. And that's one of the most amazing things. To me, the most amazing aspects of God's forgiveness, he says, he will remember our sins no more, as in God wipes it from his memory. And we could go up to God and say, God, I'm sorry about that thing I did. He's like, what thing? You know, that thing, the real bad thing I did. And he would really, literally be like, I don't know what you're talking about. I've forgotten about it. As he completely wiped it away and took it out of his memory, as if for him it has never existed. But if you want to understand forgiveness, the best place to go is Romans chapter 6. I encourage everyone to take time this week. Read through Romans 6. It explains to us exactly what happens with sin and exactly what God does for us when he forgives us our sins. And Paul in Romans 6 explains that under sin, that we become slaves to sin. We put ourselves under the dominion and power of sin. And in that sin and that evil that comes out of the sin, we just create death for ourselves. But Christ frees us from that sin and frees us from the spiritual consequences of that sin. Now, sometimes in this life, the physical consequences, they're still hanging around, but the spiritual consequences are gone. And all that promise culminates in Romans 6:23, where he says, the wages of sin is death. The natural consequence of sin is death. The wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. And so it's not just when he forgives, he forgets about the bad things that we have done, which is what he does, but the blood of Christ wipes the evil completely away from our spirits. It wipes it away from our souls that we are clean once again, erasing the debt, erasing all the spiritual consequences of our sin and evil, and restores us to life again. And in forgiveness, it enables us to live free. It enables us to live the righteous lives that we were made to live. Before Christ and without Christ, we are bound and we are dominated by the great human problem. And we have no solution that we can come up with ourselves of breaking sin and evil, because we are the problem. And it rules over our lives, it makes our decisions, it corrupts us one thought at a time, it destroys us one act at a time. Christ has done is set us free. To set us free from that sin and evil has broken us off of that old body, corrupted and infected with evil, and joined us to his body of goodness and life. Forgiveness in Christ has solved the great human problem. is the only thing that has ever solved the great human problem. If evil is the disease of humanity, then the blood of Christ is the cure. This is what forgiveness is all about. This is why forgiveness is such a big deal. It is the power to transform humanity. It is the power to cure the evil of sin. It's the power to restore us all to the way that God had originally created each and every one of us. It's the power to change lives, and in changing the lives, it's the only way we change the world. One of the greatest examples of this change, of course, there are millions and millions of examples of God changing lives through this forgiveness, but probably the greatest I've heard is back from the 18th century, all the way back to the 1700s. We're about 1750. The story of a man named John Newton. You may have heard of John Newton, and if you already heard his story, just bear with me. But John Newton was a bad guy. And I mean, he was a bad guy. I'm not talking about just the evil sinner, like the run-of-the-mill lust and greed type stuff, although there was a lot of that in there. This was a really bad dude. He took it to a whole other level, a level most human beings don't take it to. You see, John Newton was a slave ship captain, and he was involved in the slave trade, made lots of money off the slave trade, buying human beings and selling them for forced labor. And it included all the other evils that go around with that also attend selling and buying human beings. Having them in the cramped holds of the ships, underfed, malnourished, and when they died, just tossing them over the board like a piece of wood that's rotted or something. And even by his own admission, he had put down some slave rebellions. He even used torture to try to get information about who the leaders were. This guy, John Newton, this miserable sinner, he was caught in a storm one night coming back over the Atlantic. And in this storm, some crew members got knocked overboard, and he was afraid for his life. And he said he threw himself down on his knees, and he begged God for mercy. But as soon as he said that word mercy, he thought, who am I to ask the mercy of God? Who am I who have done all these awful, these terrible things? Who am I to get mercy from God? But amazingly, he was given mercy. Amazingly, John Newton survived the storm. He went back, he landed on shore safely, and I would like to say at that point, he changed his life 180 degrees. But it didn't happen that quick. Reforming a life takes time. But it did begin a journey for John Newton. And over time, one grace at a time, he reformed his life. He changed his life. And he looked back on his old life with horror and revulsion. And John Newton became a wonderful man. He became an Anglican minister. And from his pulpit was one of the most instrumental voices in ending the slave trade in England. John Newton was transformed by the mercy of God. He wrote a song about his experiences. You may have heard it. It's called Amazing Grace. You see how God solves the great human problem? No new rules, no new rituals, no ignoring the problem or blaming others. But he forces us to recognize the evil within ourselves and then offers an amazing gift in return. It's the only cure to sin and evil that actually works. See, it is pretty epic after all. It is pretty big. And I think it's just right at home with all the other big, epic ideas of the Apostles' Creed. It's pretty amazing, this forgiveness of sins. Now, I know it doesn't seem like much to a culture that doesn't believe in sin. But anyone who has felt the weight of their sin and anyone who has felt the suffering of sin, this forgiveness is the restoration of life itself. And if we talk about sin and evil up here, it's only that we can understand the enormity of God's gift to us. and hopefully better realize how these four words have changed the world for the better more than anything else. Your sins are forgiven. This is the amazing gift of our amazing God. To Him be all the glory forever and ever. Amen. Friends, will you pray with me? Blessed are you, O Lord, our God, King of the universe. Father, we come to you today and we praise you and we thank you for the forgiveness of our sins. We thank you, Lord, that you have cleaned every stain from our heart, that you have erased every evil from our souls, that you have taken the death that we allowed to take over our lives and to give us new life again. And Father, in this new life and in this grace that you have filled us with, Lord, I pray that you give us the strength to live lives that we ought to live lives of grace and mercy and love. And in first doing that, Lord, give us that strength to forgive others as you have forgiven us. Father, help us to let go of every hurt, to let go of every pain, to let go of every grudge, to let go of every hate, to let go of all malice, to forgive every pain and wrong that has been done to us, to leave it at the foot of your cross, never to pick it up again. Father, I pray that you bring new life to us through this forgiveness, and that you bring new life to a world that is chasing sin and death. We pray, Lord, that you forgive us for the sins of war, that in that forgiveness we may find true peace. Father, we pray that you forgive us for the sins of exploitation and hunger, that in that forgiveness, Lord, we find food for our souls. We pray, Lord, that you would forgive us for the sins of causing pain in the world, and that through your grace, we become instruments of your healing. We pray forgiveness, Lord, for leading people astray, for being lost, for making others weak so that we can feel strong. And in your grace, Father, may we learn to love as you love us. Father, we thank you for all these things, and we lift up the cries of our world and our lives, and we pray that you would protect us and guard us, that you would keep us, Lord, in body, soul, and spirit. You would protect us from all the attacks of sin and evil and all the schemes of Satan that are waged against us, that you would secure us in grace and mercy. Lord, we lift up all those who need healing today. We lift up Charles and Juanita and Rob and Christopher and Karen and Betty and Roger and Sharon. And pray, Lord, that you grant them strength and healing. We pray for all those who grieve today, Lord. We lift up to you, Pat, and the Lee family. We lift up to you, David, and the Jordan family. And pray, Lord, in their hour of grief and pain, that you grant them the comfort that only your Spirit can give. Lord, we lift up to you unspoken prayers. And I pray, Lord, in this moment that you would hear the silent cries of the people gathered here right now. We lift up all these prayers in the name of your Son, our Savior, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, in granting us forgiveness, God has given back our life, which was destroyed by sin. Now, there is no way that we can ever truly repay this debt, not if we had 1,000 lives and 1,000 hours in each day to try to earn it back. But what we can do is give back to God in gratitude, just a small portion of His great generosity, to support this proclamation of the good news to all the earth. If you would like to give to the ministry here at Cherokee Presbyterian, there are many ways that you can give. We have offering plates on either sides of the door as you leave the sanctuary. You can also give through Venmo, PayPal, ACH Bank Draft, or United States Postal Service. And we thank you for all the ways that you support the work and ministry here at Cherokee Presbyterian. And now in thanksgiving for all that God has given to us, let us stand and sing together our response of thanksgiving. Let us pray. Good and gracious Father, we come here today and bring these gifts to you and pray that they would be used for your service. Father, we ask that you bless both the gift and the giver, and all that we have and all that we are would be used for the advancement of your kingdom until your Son returns to us again. In his name we pray. Amen. And now we're going to continue standing saying what it is we believe using the words of the Apostles' Creed. Friends, what is it you believe? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
We are going to remain standing and sing hymn number 280, Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound.
Oh,
Friends in Christ, you have been made a new creation. Go now in the newness of life and in the fullness of our God's grace. And now may the Lord bless thee and keep thee. May the Lord make his face shine upon thee and be gracious to thee. May the Lord lift his countenance upon thee and give thee peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.